The legend has been reborn, introducing the new Hoyo de Monterey. At Hoyo, they're about craft. From seed to soil to sunshine and rain, they obsess over their labors. With skillful hands and passionate souls, they create. They do not settle. They do not concede. They are Hoyo de Monterey, and this is their craft. Experience the uniquely handcrafted Hoyo de Monterey at HoyoCigars.com. Paying homage to the mecca of tobacco, Pinar del Rio, Cuba, Abe Flores opened his PDR cigar factory in the Dominican Republic over 10 years ago. Abe is one of the hottest boutique cigar makers in the industry today, earning the number 10 spot on Cigar Aficionado's top 25 cigars of 2014 with the Abe Flores 1975 Siri Privada. Abe and his team use Cuban blending traditions in a modern boutique Dominican factory. Smoke PDR cigars and cut, light, and taste what they love to do.
Saga Cigars, makers of the Saga Golden Age. The Golden Age is a cigar that takes you back to the classic days of cigar smoking. Through the six generations of experience by the Reyes family, the Saga Golden Age delivers a timeless blend that uses the nobility of the tobacco to bring you the perfect balance of power and flavor. It narrates better than words the history of a family's tradition in tobacco, delivering a cigar much like the ones they used to smoke in the times of Hemingway. Saga Golden Age is a full-bodied, full-flavored Dominican Puro. With tobaccos from one farm, the blend features a Corojo 2006 wrapper and filler from original Cuban seeds grown in the Dominican Republic. Available in four sizes at an affordable price, the Saga Golden Age is sure to please and take you back on a journey to yesteryear.
By Rocky Patel Premium Cigars, the sun-grown Maduro is hand-rolled at Rocky Patel's boutique factory in Esteli, Nicaragua. This triple-capped, hand-bunched, and hand-rolled cigar is accompanied by a gorgeous broadleaf wrapper. Well-balanced, rich, and decadent, it truly is a great addition to any humidor and worthy of bearing the long-respected sun-grown name. For more information, visit them on the web at rockypatel.com and be sure to follow Rocky Patel Premium Cigars on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.
Our ad playing server had the hiccups or something. No worries. This is our Stogies of the Week segment. I'm on the lines with Mr. Will Cooper from North Carolina. What'd you light up now, Will?
I lit up an Azan white. Using the B cut. So I wanted to go for something a little bigger. I just got this cut. I mean, it just came. So this, I'm breaking this in, so it is new. But like I said, I'm pretty impressed with how this thing cuts. And the Duran is smoking great. So
I lit up an Opus X Power Ranger. Like mini Bellicoso. And I didn't use the V cut on the, because it has a torpedo end on it.
That I will never, I've heard of people
you can.
Do it.
I mean, you can't. Yeah. It depends on, like, how angled the Bellicoso is, right? Like, if it's a really, like, long torpedo end, you're not going to do it. But some Bellicoso, like, some manufacturers will, as you know, will call it a Bellicoso or a torpedo. Well, more Bellicoso, right, will have kind of, like, a more rounded kind of cap
right.
on it. You can use it on those. If it's got a really kind of sharp point on it, you're not going to use that V-cut.
Yeah.
What's nice is, I mean, again, Calibri's not a sponsor, but you know they gave us some product. I have this this particular cutter, which cutter and lighter. It's a lighter with a cutter built into it. And this is the lighter I've been using. And I tell you what, for the past couple of weeks, I really like this lighter and cutter combo. What's nice is, as we said on the show with Les, like I can keep this in my pocket and I always have a cutter and a lighter with me. So when I need something that the V-cut is not the best for, like a torpedo, I use the cutter that's on here and it works really well. Then it folds in and then I have you know, the triple flame on this lighter, which I've really been liking, to be honest with you, Will.
No, I mean, that's been impressive.
It's been performing really well for me. So
yeah.
But I did do a straight cut on this one, this is my second, like, kind of vintage Opus X that I've smoked on the show tonight. Just fantastic. Fantastic.
Yeah.
I do want to say, I wish I had more of those Senorio cigars, because I really like those cigars a lot.
I do too, and I tell you what, their product, they were impressed. That's how I kind of got to know them, was through the cigars, but the tequila was off the charts good. Because when you did the last show, I sent you the tequila for that show.
Yes.
So this was really my first time trying it.
Yeah, I can't wait to have a whole bottle of that extra añejo, to be honest with you.
I tell you what, it is a special bottle of tequila.
Absolutely.
It really is. And it's, I would just drink it straight. I mean, for that. I know, you know, it's probably some other things you could do, mix cocktails with, but that, enjoy that straight. You're paying that price for it. You want to get it as pure form.
I will say that I enjoyed my pairing of my Opus X with the extra añejo, but their cigars, which I paired with their tequila when they first came on the show, I thought paired much better with their tequila. Like, I think they had that in mind when they made their cigars.
I mean, when I paired the Diamante with the extra añejo, it was definitely the case.
You seemed higher on that pairing than I was with my pairing.
Yeah. It you know, and but that was a very mild cigar too, but you still got enough of the cigar flavor where neither overpowered the other.
Well, it's interesting that tequila is very it's kind of fruity. But it has the flavors are very delicate.
Yeah.
So something like an Opus X, which with some age is knocked down a little in strength, but still very full bodied, right? So there's a lot going on in an Opus X cigar, and I think it was kind of overpowering that tequila a little bit. You need, with that extra añejo, in my opinion, Will, something that has more delicate flavors to kind of balance. You know what I mean? You don't want to overpower that tequila.
I agree. I would definitely agree with that.
The cafe, very, very, for when we talk about spirits, like very full-bodied. Like it really coated my palate, and it was very heavy in my palate. Now, it wasn't syrupy, like Jonathan was saying, not syrupy at all.
Not at all.
But very heavy on the palate. I would pair that with someone was asking in the chat earlier, I wanted to expand upon that. I would pair that with a very heavy cigar. Very heavy. You know, I would kind of make that progression. Like if I was doing a tasting like they were talking about, I would take their lighter Señorío cigar and pair it with the other, you know, Blanco, Reposado, Añejo, Extra Añejo tequilas. When I got to the cafe, I would light up my second cigar and pair that with something very dark and very heavy. And that would pair very well together.
Yeah. No, I would agree on that as well. Yeah, that was $20 for that product.
That's good. Well, I mean, you know, in like a dessert liqueur like like that.
That's what I was thinking. Like, and she mentioned cheesecake. It was definitely a dessert liqueur I would have it with.
It is. And you only have like a tiny bit of that too. So your $20 is even going to be extended out, right?
Right.
I mean, because yeah, I mean, when you buy bourbon and make an old fashioned, like you use a lot of bourbon in an old fashioned, right? 2 to 3 ounces here in the studio, maybe 4 or 5, right? When you use bourbon, but when you have like a dessert liqueur like that, you use a very, like an ounce maybe.
Yeah.
And then you have one, and you're kind of done. Like it's not something you want to drink a lot of too, because it's heavy on the palate. Theirs is nice because it's not syrupy, but it's still got that like heavier flavor component to it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think you've had. Have you had Phil's Debonair coffee rum at all?
I have not tried his rums yet. Yeah, that's, is it the same? Another, I can see it the same. Yeah.
Same, yeah, but it's more on the. It's a rum, obviously, so it's going to be a little sweeter, and a little heavier, but. Very good as well. In fact, when I was at the show last year, I tried it for the first. I kept going back for more of that stuff. It was good.
Right.
Yeah.
So, Will, did you smoke your AJ Fernandez last call?
I did not. But we actually have a lot of cigars in common this week. When I noticed, we have more than normal this week. I think we.
Oh, that's good.
I think we have three. I'm looking. Excellent. Yeah, we have three cigars that we smoked.
Oh, we both smoked the Wilson Adams too. Excellent.
Yep, and we both
the Crux Limitada,
and the Quick Draw.
In the Quick Draw. Okay,
well, we smoked different sides of the... You know what's funny? So I sent you one of the packs that they sent me.
Yeah, the Quick Draw.
We need to do a swap when we're up there because I need to give you the Panatella and I need to get the Half Corona.
Okay.
So, yeah, we'll do a split. There are different sizes, so... But I think we were very similar with how we looked at those cigars.
So I'll start with my AJ Fernandez last call. I liked the story behind this cigar. This was like, you know, it's like last call at the bar, or, you know, you get towards the end of the night, you're at your friend's house and you're having cigars and you're like, oh, I really want to have another cigar, and just, you need to kind of hang out, and you need that one that's going to fill up like that 45 minute kind of time frame. And this one does that. I thought the flavors were were good. I like the closed foot on this cigar. This is what I would call a petite Corona.
Petite Corona.
But it's a ring gauge is a little fatter than most petite.
A little Coronas. Fatter, yeah. It's a petite cigar, yeah. It's not quite a petite Robusto though, I don't think.
No, it's not it's somewhere between a petite Corona and a petite Robusto. I definitely agree with that.
Would you say it's a Rothschild or
a Rothschild. I would call it a Rothschild, yes.
Okay.
Yes. I thought it was good. I thought it had good flavors. I would call it a fiver. You know, the flavors weren't off the charts, but I think that, you know, the story they kind of sent with us that went along with it really embodied the cigar as a kind of like last cigar of the day, last cigar of the night kind of thing, you know. It had flavors you could pick up on. You know, this wouldn't be your first cigar of the day or something you know, would really, like, try and pay attention to all the flavors. Like, I thought it embodied what they set it out to be, in other words.
Yeah.
So I called it a fiver.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't smoked it yet. You know, they were on a roll. This is another value price cigar they have, so it's in that $5, $6 range.
Yep.
They've been on a roll with that, but they had the bar very high with some of those, with the Enclaves and the New Worlds. So, I don't know. Like I said, I haven't smoked it yet, but you know they've had the bar very high with those value price cigars. So it'll be interesting to see where this comes in. But the feedback I've heard from other people's similar to yours. That's probably what I'm saying. It's not a bad cigar, but yeah.
Yeah, like a value price cigar that you would reach for at the end of the night.
Yep.
Nailed it. Back to you, Will.
This is one of those cigars that sometimes it pays to go back and smoke it again. And I smoked the Espinosa Murcielago Noir. The Noir is actually the Robusto size.
Okay.
So, story with this cigar is, this is the cigar he used to make with Eddie Ortega, Eric Espinosa. When Eddie and Eric split, they divided the brands of their company. So Eric took the 601 brand and the Murcielago brand, and Eddie took like Cabal and some other brands. But when Eric took the brands, he no longer had access to the factory that was making this cigar, and they would not share the blend with him. But Eric was a big fan of that cigar, and Murcielago was probably one of the first prominent Mexican wrapper cigars. So they actually went on a project where they had to reverse engineer the blend. So they literally started buying up all the Murcielagos they can find. They dissected them, they smoked them, and they recreated a blend. I can't say if that blend is the original, and I don't think I'll ever be able to tell that for a while, because anything that's out there is aged a long time.
Oh, I see. Yeah, so it's tough to do a comparison.
So I didn't do a comparison when I reviewed this. Now, when I smoked it at the trade show, I thought it was okay. When I smoked it, when I was down at Espinosa's, the Espinosa event, and it was better, but I went back and actually reviewed this thing, and it's damn good. And it's one of those interesting things where Dave Burke of Cigar, our friend from Cigar Jukebox, happened to also be smoking this around the same time I am, and he had the same impressions that this cigar is really, really good. Whatever they recreated, it aged out fantastic. Now, it's a fuller cigar. So it's definitely it's full body. You're gonna feel the flavors on your palate. It's a medium to full in terms of strength, but I think it really, like I said, I think it was an excellent cigar, and I gave it a box worthy on this cigar. I was real impressed with this cigar. I probably would have had it at between Try One and Fiver a year ago, but you know that was coming out of the trade show. This it was much better now.
Awesome. I can't wait to try. I have a Murcielago in my humidor. I don't know which one it is, though, Will.
Okay, so here's how you could tell. I have a picture of my Stogie feed. Mm-hmm. If the band has yellow in it or gold, it's the old one.
Okay.
The new one's strictly black and red.
I think mine's strictly black and red.
So that I think I sent you one.
Okay. So someone
I think
sent
I
me.
Sent you one.
Yeah. So yeah. It's interesting. Recently, executive producer Keith and I went through, and we probably do this once a month, Will, because of all the influx of cigars that we get here that people are kind enough to send us, which we want to review, and the ones that I go by so that we can review, and the ones that Will go by that we can review. It's kind of a mixture of how we acquire cigars here for the Stogie Geeks. Long story short, there's always an influx of cigars into the humidors here in the studio, and they get really messy.
Right.
And you know this, Will. Now, luckily, I have Keith to help me sort through everything. And we did a big sorting through the other day. And this, I know this cigar is in my review tray, and I know it just has black and red in the band.
Yep.
So, yeah.
You know what it is? Yeah. So definitely check it out. It's classic San Andreas is what I'll say. But, you know, there's a fourth category. And I got to thank, because I've gotten some, there's been some listeners who have absolutely been very generous. I got to thank in particular, because I got packages from our friend Kruk and from Don Knott in the last week.
Nice.
So I'm very appreciative of those things. So thank you very much. And I know, you know, Big Pete's been very generous.
Absolutely.
You know,
yeah, Pete and
Pino
have done a lot of trading.
Yeah.
Jim's given us a lot of cigars to try. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So thanks to the listeners and viewers as well.
So we have a couple different categories of cigars here in the studio. So you come visit the studio, there's like ones that are Paul's stash. Like those are like my personal stash of cigars. And I sometimes give those out to people that visit. Then there's my review cigars, right? Then there is contest cigars, which I can't smoke because they're for contests. And then there's unbanded smokes, which no one else can smoke but me because we're doing unbandeds for Will and I. And we're going to do 111 and 112 on this show, Will.
Okay.
I hope you're ready for that.
I only did one.
Okay.
So, okay, yeah.
You probably did 111, right?
The closed foot one.
Was that 111?
I think it was 111, yeah.
Okay, that was 111.
Yeah.
And then I have, like, this, like, general cigars to give to people that come to the studio kind of thing. They're like cigars that we've reviewed, that we have extra, that we give to people who come here in the studio or are friends of the show, that we want their opinion on above and beyond ours. Like, we've reviewed it. We know what our rating is on it. We have extras, and we give those to people to get their review on it as well. So it's pretty cool to have all those different, you know, kinds of cigars to give to people. And I love sharing all the the feedback on all those cigars with all of our listeners. So. This one was one for me to review, which Will Cooper sent me. It is the Filthy Hooligan from Alec Bradley, and this is the Barber Pole from 2016. I thought this was a good cigar. I thought that the earthiness component in the cigar, Will, was very good. And I thought the Candela kind of balanced some of that earthiness with a little bit of that herbal component that you get from that Candela wrapper. And I thought it was good, and I rated it a fiver.
I had it. I didn't quite have it like that. I didn't find I got enough of the barber pole with that. I thought it was still a little more Candela-ish. I gave it a try one. But with all the Filthy Hooligans, they've gotten better over time. That's just been my experience with them.
Interesting.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think it's a bad cigar. Like I said, I didn't get that earthiness that I thought I would get from the barber pole with that.
Yeah, see, I did. I definitely did.
Yeah.
I definitely got an earthiness component to it. And I question myself sometimes when I try and pick out flavors from cigars, right? Because we smoke a lot of cigars. But I definitely, this one sticks in my mind is having herbal balanced with that earth, which was a nice complement to each other.
Yeah.
And is that Honduran tobacco that they're using in this, Will?
Yeah.
Which
there's Honduran and there's some Nicaraguan in there as well.
Which explains the earthiness. So.
Yeah. I think it's a Honduran Candela they're using on that too, but that I'm not 100% sure of
that. It wouldn't surprise me. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
Back to you, Will.
So this is a cigar I got around to smoking over the last week for the first time, and this one is a what I'm going to say is it's probably the most under the radar cigar release this year.
And I knew what it was as soon as you started talking.
Yeah,
And I smoked more of these lately because you said you reviewed it.
Yeah, and then I went back. And I told you about it. It's the Griffin's Nicaragua Robusto. Actually, I've smoked the Short Torpedo as well. This cigar, look, everyone knows Davidoff Nicaragua. We're going to talk a little more about that. They know the Avo Cinco Nicaragua. If you don't know this cigar, tell your Davidoff dealer to bring this cigar in, okay? Because they don't even have to be white label to get it. This cigar is amazing. Because it technically came out last year in Europe, I'm debating if it's going to be eligible for my list this year. But it is an unbelievable cigar. Is all I could say.
No, it has to be eligible for your list this year, Will.
It's that
good. I'm going to push for that.
We may have to push for that, but
make an exception. We'll put a little asterisk next to it.
It did come out in the U.S. this year.
Yeah.
And it's not a for Griffins. It's a little more bolder than your milder Griffins. Like, some of the Griffins actually are stronger than, some of those limiteds.
Yeah, the limiteds are stronger than their regular line. Their regular line tends to be very, very, very mild.
Yeah.
Their limiteds are medium, medium, full. And where did you say this one ranks?
Dead medium, I thought it was.
I would agree, 100%.
Yeah.
Dead medium.
Every one of these was a set it and forget it burn. I didn't have to do anything on these cigars, right?
But I had the same experience, if that tells you anything about this cigar, right?
Yeah, the ash comes off that big chunk, but most of all the flavors there. It's a complex blend. You get that hay pepper.
There's a peppery component to this cigar too.
There's definitely a peppery component to this cigar. But there's plenty of flavor. There's great tobacco flavor. I even got a little cocoa along the way with this thing. I was real pleased with this cigar, and it's just one that didn't get a big push with Davidoff. It's $10.50, not gonna break the bank.
You paid $10.50 in North Carolina.
I got these from you. But I did pick up a Short Torpedo.
So the Robusto for me is not, I thought it was $9.75.
Okay. It may vary from.
I say that, Will, because I've smoked at least five of the Short Torpedo and five of the Robusto since I reviewed it.
I usually hate a Short Torpedo. I think torpedoes, they have to be over 5 inches.
Yeah.
This is a 4x52. It's one of the best Short Torpedoes I've had. To me, this cigar, I know Griffin's is marketed for Europe, and I get it.
Mm-hmm.
But this cigar is Davidoff's kind of hidden gem right now. That's out there. This is a regular production cigar. It's box worthy for sure. I think it could be Chuck Norris before things are said and over with this thing right now.
I 100% agree with your rating. I would rate it the same way. I would say it's box worthy now. In fact, the reason that I smoked so many of these is I'm debating, do I want a box of the Short Torpedo or do I want a box of the Robusto? And I can't make up my mind which one I want. So I'm going and buying in like a couple of each size. And, well, I'm really high on this cigar. You think about like our top 10 list, and you think of like our Oasis rating, but to have a cigar like this that is medium-bodied with tons of flavor, that has that peppery component, that has some of the best burn-drawn construction out of cigars I smoked this year, that has two great sizes that we've smoked. Not horrible. I mean, it's not great, but they're commanding the value. And I see the value in this cigar because this is one where I could smoke multiple of the same cigar in a day, even of a different size. And I'm like totally satisfied. I'm really glad I'm smoking this cigar. Like I'm not ever bored with it. And that really speaks to, the rating. And I agree. It's a solid box worthy. I think with age, it's going to move into Chuck Norris. And just the smokeability of this cigar is off the charts. I can't say enough good things about this cigar. Well, I can't.
I could say it's the best Griffins maybe to come out, including some of the limiteds. I'm putting it at that level. It's definitely the best regular production one they've done.
Oh, yeah, hands down.
I mean, like I said, you know, it's a little harder to find the Griffins, and a lot of retailers are hesitant. You know, my local guy was hesitant to bring this cigar in, but he smoked it. He liked it, and I think he's going to bring it in now based on there's been some demand for it. So I would, like I said, I think it's the most under the radar release that's come out this year, without question.
I mean, here we are. We're almost in May, right? We smoked a lot of new releases so far this year.
Right.
This is one of my favorite. This is one I would reach for. It sticks out in my mind. I buy them when I see them in the store. I smoke a ton of them. I never get bored with it. It's one of the cigars that came out this year in the U.S. that are just really sticking in my mind and commanding a high rating and a lot of smokeability. So I strongly encourage our listeners to go find the cigar and smoke it. You're going to be surprised. Take whatever you think about Griffin and throw it out the window and just smoke it. And I mean, the Griffin limited editions are different than this cigar. They stand on their own, right?
They're very different, yeah. I would not lump this in there.
And it's nothing like the milder Griffin's regular productions either. I love this cigar. I can honestly say I love this cigar.
Packaging was brilliant. The black band.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's just everything down. And I understand why they put it into Europe first, because it's probably got more legs in Europe, but... this also, I don't talk about numeric ratings on this show a lot. I did give it a 93 on Coupe, which there's only been a couple of cigars that go 94, and they're more limited stuff.
Right.
So giving it, there's not a lot of 93s given out on Cigar Coupe either. So this, like I said, I want to see more. I saw one other review of it that was very positive too. So besides ours.
Yeah, it's interesting, Will. I mean, you and I don't. I mean, we agree on some cigars, but for you and I to basically speak the same way about this cigar in really every aspect really says something about it.
Yeah. It's just like I said. I can't say a lot of negative. It's probably going to be better. Like I said, the way I read this thing, usually you can make a good prediction on aging, and I think the potential you could tell it's there.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Awesome. I smoked two. So earlier today, I smoked a Torpedo and a Robusto on the previous show.
There's a 6x60 that's, I think it's already out in Europe.
Yeah.
But it's coming out at the show. I'll tell you what, I want to see what this thing does in the 6x60.
Oh, absolutely. I would smoke this blend in any size because it's performed so well in the two sizes. So is it only in the short Torpedo and the Robusto? That's all I've seen in our local shop
right now.
Here.
Right now, the 6x60, I think it's already out in Europe, but it's planned at the show. If anyone from Davidoff is listening, give this cigar a push, man, because you got a really great giant.
Yep.
Yeah, you really do.
I smoked a CEO Pilon Robusto.
Okay.
This again, Will, had this earthiness component to it, which I really liked.
Yeah.
And not a lot of cigars impressed me with the earthiness. Like, earthiness is not, it's a weird kind of flavor profile, right? But this one definitely had that earthiness component, but it was very smooth and creamy in the same respect, which made me really like it, right? Now, it didn't change up a lot throughout the whole cigar, but I thought this was a solid fiver. And a good offering from CAO, and if you like that smooth earthiness component to your cigars, definitely reach for one of these.
Yeah, you know, I like that blend. It was a more traditional CAO blend from just the blend to the packaging. I thought it was a solid cigar. I agree. It's a very good cigar. I think I had it actually as a box split, but I mean, we're pretty close on that one as well, and I kind of agree with you on that. It's a very traditional cigar, which is kind of untraditional for CAO, which is kind of known for a little more edgier stuff. I think they did.
And you know what? It is. You're right. I mean, it's different from the, you know, like the Camacho blends. I don't know why I'm comparing it to Camacho, but I think of like how they did their repackaging, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And this CAO is definitely like a different band and a different kind of feel for CAO.
Yeah, like Camacho went more to edgier packaging. CAO went much more somewhat traditional. I don't want to say it's totally, For CAO, it's, you know, and the whole thing, there's a story where they're aging the tobacco in circular pilones, which was an old Cuban technique that kind of fell out of favor because it's an expensive technique to maintain. Mm. The one thing I couldn't say about it is I don't know what the circular thing is, and I know CAO is a sponsor. I would need to compare it with that same blend, with those same tobaccos aged with traditional pilones, and then I can make a fair assessment with that. So, you can't do that. That's so. Otherwise, I could just say whatever they're doing works well with the cigar.
It does. It does. I think it presents like a kind of a unique flavor profile for me, that has that smoothiness and creaminess, but that earthiness component is what I got from the cigar. So, is somewhat unique. And if you look at the wrapper in the picture, like, it's really like a shiny, oily kind of wrapper too.
Yeah. Oh, it's very oily, that wrapper. Yeah. Yeah. One of the more oily wrappers to come out. It's a thick wrapper. But it burned well for me, that thick wrapper. Mm. I didn't have too many issues with it.
Back to you, Will.
So I got a couple of Connecticuts that we both smoked, and I think they were two completely different Connecticuts. So I'll start off. Southern Draw Cigars has a new release called the Quick Draw Connecticut, which is their first Connecticut shade cigar they're doing. They actually came out, the Quick Draw line is a line of quick smokes that they come out with. They're meant to be smoked 30, 35 minute time frame. So they actually came out with two sizes, a Petite Corona, I think you're going to talk about that, and a Short Panatella, which is kind of, I would say, Short Lancero. Mm-hmm. Kind of. It wasn't one of these cigars I felt that was trying to reinvent Connecticut. It was it's in that mild to medium range. It wasn't an overly creamy Connecticut. It had a lot of classic wood notes in there. There was a slight bitter component to this, which normally I'd say in Connecticut I don't like it, but it was just a slight bitter component. But it was, again, I felt the bitterness actually worked in favor of what this cigar was doing, where it balanced out some of the other flavors in there.
I agree. Wholeheartedly with that statement, Will. Yes.
Yeah. I liked it a lot. Good price point. It's in the $5 to $6 range, this cigar. They recommended pairing it with a Cafe Cubano. I didn't pair it with a Cafe Cubano.
What's a Cafe Cubano?
A Cuban coffee.
Okay. Cuban coffee is, what do you do with the?
They put a lot of sugar. They make it with a lot of sugar in it.
So it's black coffee with sugar?
Yeah, there's a technique where they actually they kind of caramelize the sugar.
Okay.
And then mix it in there. And I just, you know, I could see where they were going with. I could see what we had Robert Holt on the show. With that. I think the cigar would work great with a black coffee without sugar, personally.
I did. I smoked both mine that I reviewed with a black coffee in the morning.
Yeah, I gave it a box split. I thought it was good.
I did, too. And I smoked a different size than you. I smoked a Petite Corona. And I smoked two of them for this review because I love smoking Connecticuts in the morning with coffee. And I thought it was really good. And I agree with your assessment. Well, it had, like, a little bit of bitterness component, but it had some of that traditional tobacco flavors. It wasn't like your smooth, creamy Connecticut.
No, wasn't.
It mixed it up enough with a little bit of bitterness, a little bit of those wood notes, like you said, that kind of set it apart. And it's something that I would reach for in the morning with coffee more often, right? Like sometimes, like, I'm in the mood for a smoother and creamier kind of Connecticut, but sometimes I want something with like a little bit of bite to it, a little bit of punch to it. More of like on the woody notes and more on the bitter note. And this one did it for me. And I smoked two of them. I love the closed foot on the cigar a lot. I thought that really enhanced the smoking experience. Both of mine smoked awesome. And I rated this one a box split. I would totally work this in my morning smoking rotation. It, you know, it'd be one of those cigars where it kind of, for me, it kind of wakes your palate up, right? It makes you pay attention to your palate, right? Because with the smoothie creamier Connecticuts, I don't have to think a lot to, like, get those flavors from it, right? But with this one, it had those subtle bitter components and kind of those subtle wood components that made me want to pay attention to it a little more and see how it kind of offset with my coffee in the morning. And I really liked that a lot. I did.
Yeah. Yeah. And I had a lot of folks ask about this cigar. Now, they just released it. What Robert Holt, who, if you check out episode 169, he was our guest on there. Mm. What Robert Holt told us is he's kind of rolling it out at a series of events right now that he's doing. And then the full rollout's going to be in the June, July timeframe. So probably around July, right before IPCPR, you'll start seeing he's hit a lot more stores right now. But it's definitely a cigar worth checking out.
Definitely something that wakes my palate up in the morning.
Yeah.
Pairs really well with coffee. You know, a lot of the Connecticuts I rate are in that smoother, creamier component, but this one mixes it up nicely. And I was impressed with the cigar, Will.
Me too.
This might have been, you know, like my cigar of the week, to be honest with you.
It was very good. It was very good.
I don't know. There was a couple of Connecticuts that were really impressive to me. And the other one was that Wilson Adams Black Label number 4.
Yeah. And go ahead, because now I thought this was completely different than this one.
Completely different, right? Like, this one for me. Like when I first lit it up, I was like, wow, that's kind of, had a very bitter component to it, almost a spiciness to it when I first lit it up. And I was like, wow, that's kind of weird. But I'm like, I'm kind of digging it. And then I'm like, it changed. And I got this like little bit of herbalness and a little bit of almost like a fruitiness from it.
Yes.
And it had these like nuances as I started smoking it and it started opening up. And I'm like, wow. And in fact, I commented to Mark when I was smoking the cigar. When I first lit up, I'm like, Mark, I don't know what this cigar is doing. I'm like, it's very different. And then I went back to him later. I'm like, Mark, this is pretty awesome because it's opening up with this like fruity herbal component, but still has those Connecticut traditional kind of flavors that are prominent, but the nuances were fruity and herbal, and I'm like, I'm really digging this cigar a lot, and I really, really liked it. I really, really liked it with coffee because it stayed somewhat traditional, but introduced some nuances that kept you entertained as you smoked it, and paired very well with coffee, and I rated it a box split. I like this Connecticut cigar a lot. This is another one that I would work into my rotation in the morning with coffee.
Did I send you more than one of those?
Just one. I wish you said more because I liked it.
Okay, oh. I think I may have one more left, or one more for each of us left. But this got thanks to Brandon Wilson, who episode 140 he was a guest on. A couple of things about that cigar. The blend was very interesting on this thing. It's using Nicaraguan filler and Ecuadorian Sumatra binder. The Connecticut shade wrapper was Honduran from Palanga. So that, you know. If you had to look at the majority of Connecticut shade wrappers on the market,
It's
Ecuadorian and U.S.
Right.
So you don't. It's not that Palanga is not used. In fact, I was at a Connecticut shade farm in Honduras, so I do know they grow it there. Yeah. A lot of it. It's just you don't see much of it. But yeah, so I thought the blend was different. I thought this cigar had the fruit component was absolutely there. I thought this cigar had a lot more body. I thought this cigar was heading up towards that medium plus in terms of body.
Yep.
So I thought it was a little more bolder with that. And I think it's going to stay there. I don't think this is something that's going to kind of pitter out on that. So I think I thought there was a nice level of complexity with this cigar. Like you said, there were a lot of nice change-ups with this cigar as well. I agree. It didn't follow the script for Connecticut Shade, much like the Quick Draw didn't follow a script per se, but wasn't that creamy, but very good with coffee. I gave it a box split as well.
Which I think is great that in the market today, you have your choice as to what you can smoke for a Connecticut cigar, right? Which I think is awesome. And for those of us that love to enjoy cigars in the morning, it's like the greatest time to enjoy Connecticut
cigars. I smoke a lot in the morning. Yeah, I smoke a lot in the morning for reviewing.
And especially these ones that you sent me, the two, Southern Draw and the Wilson Adams, I'm like, this is great. Like, I have these Connecticut cigars. I can work them out of rotation. I can choose what I'm in the mood for. I can have something different. If I want something smoother and creamier, I can go that route. If I want something with a fruity component if I want something that has a little bit of a bitter component, like I have all these options now, mm-hmm. which I just think is just so awesome. I mean, I have my Connecticut cigars, which I really love are my staples, but all these new ones are really impressing me for the most part. I mean, there are some Connecticuts I smoke that I'm like, eh, no, I wouldn't work that in my rotation. But these two definitely this week, I'm like, I'm so glad people are making really awesome Connecticut cigars. I really am. Because I love to have these first thing in the morning with coffee. And to have all these options is fantastic in the market today.
I agree. Now, you know, last year we talked about the high-profile Connecticuts, the Padron that came out and Undercrown Shade. A lot of people said it was Year of the Connecticut. I kind of disagreed. I didn't think there was a lot of them. But this year's another story. Mm. A lot of Connecticuts coming out. And there's been a lot of misses, too. We probably haven't hit those misses. Right. But I think Connecticut Shade is the big topic. What I'm also hearing is that I'm hearing a lot of talk from various people because it's getting harder to get San Andreas, that you're going to see a decline in that. So manufacturers are probably going to push more to Connecticut. So I think this year is going to be a very, very big year with Connecticut. And this is just two releases that have come out recently.
Yeah,
these are new releases.
The Padron Damaso, to me, I think it gets better with age. I think the Undercrown Shade embodies that little more of the smoothie creaminess component to it. I think that Ernesto Perez Carrillo like fully takes on that smoothie creamy component, which I'm going to move for that. I'd reach for one of those. And he's got a couple of different lines in that Connecticut that just work great. But it's nice to see these other manufacturers making some different offerings that I can also smoke in the morning.
Yeah.
Which is, I mean, smoking in the morning with coffee is just, ugh. So awesome.
Nice piping hot black coffee. And, you know, like I said, both of these cigars had a real place for that morning smoke and just variety and what options you can bring to the table.
That's great. Well, let's get off the Connecticut for a while because we've been hopping on that.
Yep. What do you got?
I want to think that, you know, I want to get the reputation for only smoking Connecticuts.
No.
I want to go opposite. I want to go this Crux Limitada PB5.
I smoked that one too. So.
Yeah, because I think this is a great cigar, Will. I really do.
Wow. Opposite
change from the Connecticut, right? Like, this is like the body on this cigar is just amazing. I get like this caramel kind of component to it. There's a lot of change-ups happening. This is a fantastic cigar. I rated the cigar box-worthy. I don't know what it was about this cigar, Will, but it was just awesome. It wasn't really spicy or heavy, but it was really, really full-bodied and full-flavored. And to do that in a cigar, I think is really amazing. I really like this one a lot. I would definitely smoke more of these. Again, like that just caramel kind of notes that came from this cigar were very unique.
Yeah, there was a nice sweetness. I don't know if I got the caramel, but I got more, but there was a sweetness. There was a lot going on with this cigar. Mm. I'll tell you this, if this is a cigar, it's one of those cigars I would say, if you really smoke it, like, in isolation, you're gonna pick up a lot more with that.
Yeah,
I had had it down when I was in Florida, and actually I had a chance to talk to the Crux people, great people, and I've been kind of high on some of the Crux Connoisseur Lanceros. I really like. I know Mr. J's got them. Stogie Santa was telling me about this cigar. Mm-hmm. He had smoked the Limitada PB5, and you know when Stogie Santa gets on a cigar, when he gets behind a cigar, he gets behind it.
Right.
And he was raving about this cigar. And I completely agree on this cigar. It's a box worthy cigar. There's an interesting component to the cigar. They're using a proprietary wrapper that they were able to source called Ignacio. Ignacio or something. I'm gonna mix it. But there's a proprietary Nicaraguan wrapper they're using on this thing. And apparently Crux has been able to secure this for some period of time exclusively. There's There's someone in the cigar industry who helped with this blend, I was told, mm-hmm. but didn't blend it. And the name has come out there, but I don't know if Crux wants the name out there, so I'm just going to kind of leave it at that. But it's someone very prominent out there, and they even put that in the press release, but they didn't want to put the name. This is a great cigar. I thought I liked the box press. It was kind of that Cuban style box press they were using on that as well.
Yeah, like a soft box press.
A soft box press, yeah. Mm-hmm. I think it's the best release that Crux has come out with to date as well. And it's another cigar I could see landing, end of the year list. Yeah, it's a great cigar.
And, I mean, I would never smoke this cigar in the morning.
No.
This is an after lunch kind of thing. You could pair this with a lot of different spirits, cocktails. I don't think it pairs very well with coffee, to be honest with you.
No, not at all. There's too much yet. Yeah.
You could pair this with beer, spirits, cocktails.
Florida Tanya.
Yeah, rum.
Yeah, rum.
It would go really well with rum. I agree. Just a really, really great cigar. This is one of my highlights for sure. Speaking of Crux, Will, I smoked the Crux Sports.
I smoked that one too a few weeks ago. Yeah, I want to hear what you say about
it. Yeah, so this is a nice, short smoking cigar. Very petite Corona. Would you call it a petite Corona? Would you call it a short Corona?
It's kind of one step above Cigarillo, I would say, but it's not Cigarillo.
No, yeah. Excuse me. It doesn't smoke like a Cigarillo.
No, it does not.
It smokes like a regular. I mean, Cigarillos tend to burn really hot. Have a lot of like pepper and spice and really kind of like attack your palate. And if you're in the mood for that, that's fine. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. But this one smoked more like a regular cigar, right? Like it didn't burn too hot. You got a lot of flavor from it. And I thought they were really good. I could see this one being like a end of the night kind of cigar, like we talked about the last call, right?
Yeah.
Like you're like, oh, I really want to. Like, I don't know, it was at the end of the day. We were having some cocktails.
End of the day, but I don't want to stay up late. And
we were having some cocktails here in the studio, and I had, like, another half an hour, 45 minutes. And I'm like, I want to smoke something because we're all just kind of hanging out, commiserating, talking about our day kind of thing. And it worked really well for that environment. I could see, in the car, driving home, end of the day kind of thing. It's got a good, strong kind of peppery, little spicy component to it. Lot of body on it, but not hard. A lot of times what I find in these smaller cigars like this, Will, is they're like almost a little harsh and burn hot, but this one didn't do that. It still gave you that same experience of giving you that full flavor, but didn't turn harsh or burn hot. So I like that, and I called it a fiver because they come in these little five packs. I would totally have one of these little five packs. I liked it. I like that cigar. One of my more favorite, I think, smaller cigars like this.
Yeah, and I reviewed it a few weeks ago, and what I liked about it, and I'm not a Cigarillo fan. Mm-mm. This is a 35 ring gauge that's on this thing, so it's kind of like it's smaller than Lancero, but there was nothing Cigarillo like about this cigar. I gave it a fiver when I had smoked it, but again, for what that cigar is, it's got a great price point too. I mean, if you break up those five packs, it comes out to $375 a cigar. So I mean, and it's a great end. Like you said, end of the day is a great way to put that cigar too. I'm not one to kind of like to go outside and puff a cigar for a half hour.
Yeah, this would be a great winter cigar, but I'm not like that either.
Yeah. No, I mean, and Crux has done, they've done a very good job with these smaller ring gauge and shorter smokes. They have but they do a good job on the bigger sizes as well. So, but yeah, I like this cigar. It was a good cigar.
Back to you, Will.
I'm done.
Interesting. Okay, good.
You smoked a lot this week. You caught up.
I was catching up.
Yeah.
Davidoff Nicaragua box press.
You spoke to Robusto.
That's the Robusto, not the Toro.
Yeah, I haven't said that. Yeah.
I thought the cigar was good. I don't know. I mean, I put a rating on it, but I think, as we said, the Nicaragua blend for me, Will, is it's different in that when I smoke the different sizes and I smoke the different sizes that have different age, I get a completely different experience. And this one for me, I mean, it had good flavors. It smoked well, but it's almost like the jury's kind of still out on some of these Nicaraguans. I've smoked some that are like pretty amazing, and I've smoked some that are like this one is a fiver for me. And I wanted to like the cigar more, but it was still just a fiver for me. I mean, not that a fiver is a bad rating, but
I felt
it could have been more, maybe with age, or if I had smoked more of them. Like, I only had one to smoke for this review, and I thought it was good, but it didn't wow me like I expected the Nicaraguan blend from Davidoff to do. And some of the short Coronas have wowed me. some of the Toros have wowed me. But some of them with maybe not as much age really haven't wowed me. So I don't know. I'm kind of, you know how much I love the Davidoff blends. And this one just didn't wow me.
So the important point about this blend is it is a different blend.
Interesting.
Okay. It's using an Oscuro wrapper as opposed to a Rosado.
Mm.
So there is some differences in the blend. It's not the same blend. I have not done a smoke that I would consider reviewable. I did smoke this. I thought it needed some time. So I kind of pushed it back in the rotation to kind of, you know, give it a little more time. I am going to be reviewing this probably in the next week.
Okay.
But I definitely saw that. But it is a different blend. You need to keep that in mind, plus a different format.
But I want to smoke more of these. I think age is going to be kind to them, but I wasn't like really excited about this one, I thought I was gonna be, I guess was the thing. I would like to smoke this unbanded, you know what I mean, and see what that does too. But to talk about Davidoff, and I didn't put it in my Stogie. I don't know how it didn't make it in, Will. You didn't smoke the golf, the new what?
Nope.
What's the new one?
The scorecard, because you got them. Yeah. I need you to send them to me.
I smoked two scorecards this week too. I didn't put them in there.
No.
I apologize. I thought the scorecard was friggin' awesome, by the way.
I need that cigar. I got it.
So you'll probably get them tomorrow. We shipped them.
Oh, yeah.
We shipped them yesterday or the day before.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So they're on their way to you, okay. Along with a light box. Some of the cigars you'll see, we have a new light box here in the studio because we're geeks. Nerds or dorks, whatever you want to call us, right?
Right.
We get a new light box to take pictures in. But your light box is coming, so you'll see improved photo quality here at the Stogie Geeks. But the Davidoff scorecard, Will, that you had sent me, they come in the 5-pack.
Right.
Box worthy. Oh, my God. Is that cigar awesome?
Like, really?
Classic Davidoff, tons of flavors, like a saltiness component from it, which I've gotten from those Davidoff cigars in the past. Box worthy all day long. That cigar is absolutely phenomenal with coffee. Like that, we talked about milder cigars. The flavor profile is just off the charts, but that it's kind of like when you mix like that saltiness component with chocolate, right? And you get that little bit of saltiness when you have coffee. And it just really balances together. It was awesome. It was awesome. Like a little bit of that grass. I want to call it herbal. Like a little bit of that grassiness too as well. So it's very traditional Davidoff, which I like a lot. Not over the top. Like very, very well done. That blend is spot on. Spot on Davidoff. High-end Davidoff. I'm sure those cigars are expensive, right? Well, what's it cost for?
They're about 25 a piece.
Yeah, no, you.
But that totally was we got actually a very good deal on those cigars. So there was a slight discount and free shipping, which is why I grabbed it. Because I saw nothing that came close to that. So
it was phenomenal. Yeah. Love the new scorecard. Equally as good as those golf. The golf Robusto. It was like a longer golf Robusto.
Which yeah, the golf. I like that cigar.
The golf Robusto was better than the one that came in the tube. The tube was a little bigger. Yeah, the Toro.
Yeah, I agree with you on that.
The scorecard is a Toro.
The scorecard is
somewhere in between a Toro and a Robusto, isn't
somewhere
it?
Somewhere in between. Yeah,
it's like a longer Robusto, and I have some of those Robustos left, and I almost don't want to smoke them because they're so amazing. The scorecard. I mean, if you loved that Davidoff classic profile, this kicks it up several notches from that. I mean, you're going to really love this cigar, and I did. I can't get enough of this cigar.
Yeah, I had heard from people who've had both. Everyone's telling the Golf was very good. People are saying this one's even better.
Yeah.
They only come in, like, so the only bad thing about this is it's only, like, most of the retailers aren't breaking up the five packs. I have just started to see retailers break up the Golf editions from last year, though.
Okay.
I mean, it took, they were eight packs. Mm. So you had to buy that whole thing. But this particular limited's been a solid line by Davidoff where they really haven't dropped the ball with it.
No, they kicked it up several notches, dude.
Yeah. I agree. So I'm looking forward to that a lot.
Yeah, you're going to like the scorecard.
Good.
For sure. I smoked two of them, and I have one left. One of them has a gold band on it. That's just a different band. It's not anything special.
Yeah, because I kind of kept the gold band on the Robusto. I figured you were going to keep that one.
I did. I kept one in the gold band because I'm like, that's so cool. I'm like, I really love this
cigar. But guess what? I have my gold band from last year on the Robusto, and I still haven't smoked it.
Yeah, like, so you don't want to smoke it because it has this like special band on it.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I figured when they were up there, you were going to keep the gold band, but I'm like, it's the same cigar, hopefully. So.
It is.
Yeah.
It is the same exact cigar. It's just a different band, but, you know, well done by Davidoff.
Yeah, really, really, I mean, good year they're having so far.
I also smoked a Gurkha Royal Challenge Toro.
Yep.
And that was the one. Is this also a Connecticut shade?
It's a Connecticut shade. They have a Maduro as well. That's a cigar that's been on the market for a while. Actually.
Okay.
It's not a new one. It's been out for 5 years.
Yeah, this was given to me by the local Gurkha rep. I wasn't high in the cigar. And we just talked about, you know, Connecticut cigars that we really, really like. This one seemed to me like they used a lower priming or, you know, different kind of tobaccos that maybe weren't fermented as long. It wasn't horrible. I mean, I smoked the whole thing, but it was just a try one. There was nothing compelling about this cigar. I mean, the burn, drawn construction was great. It had, you know, a little bit of a grassy component, a little bit of an earthy component, but the flavors just didn't jump out for me on this cigar, Will, at all. And I wanted to like it because I think Gurkha gets a bad rep, to be honest with you.
I think they do it. I think they have some blends that, and I know you have a couple of the others that are surprisingly good.
Yeah, like their Cellar Reserve, I think, is really good. I remember their Black Dragon was an
Shaggy.
Awesome blend.
And
it's interesting. Yeah. The Black Dragon, I actually unbanded to Mark Jr. and Stogie Santa, and they loved it.
Yeah, I bought a box of those actually, and they were on clearance a few years ago, and they come in that nice big
Great cigar.
Yeah,
Gurkha makes some great cigars. This one
just has the cedar on it. Has the cedar on it?
No, mine didn't have the cedar on it.
Okay, they have ones with cedar on it. I think I'm confusing the Red Dragon, but yeah, one
could
of them
be,
has cedar.
Yeah.
On it. Yeah.
But this one just it didn't seem like it didn't have enough character for me to really like it and want to smoke more of it than a try one. They'll put it that way.
It's been a while since I smoked it. I'm not going to say I've smoked it probably in the last 3 years. I haven't. From what I remember about it, it wasn't bad. I think your assessment's on. It seemed like they definitely went for lower priming tobaccos.
Yeah.
And to keep the cost down, because they did put some nice, there's some ornate packaging they have with that box.
Right.
It kind of seemed like they did that. But it's not a bad cigar by any means, in terms of it. So I haven't smoked it in about 3 years, though, so it's been a while. So I don't think you're too far off on that.
So, Will, let's do some unbandeds.
Didn't we do 111?
No.
You have the envelope?
No, last week, remember, I was sick. We didn't smoke it.
But we did it the week before.
The week before? No.
You have an envelope with 111 in it.
I have an envelope with 111 in it.
Okay.
This was a Robusto-ish size cigar.
Was it like with a closed foot?
Can you see it?
Go to the other one. I don't think I smoked that one.
No?
No.
The one from last week. Remember I said I didn't smoke it because I was sick? And then you said, I didn't smoke it either?
Okay, I thought we did one. I know I did 112. Then I did 112. I thought we did that one.
112 was more like a Corona ish.
Is that 112?
112 is a Corona ish size cigar.
Yeah, I did 112.
That's 112 right there.
Okay.
So okay, you did 112. All right, I did 112 today too.
Yeah. We'll let you do 111 as well. We'll let you do 111.
Well, 111 was just it was good. It was I don't remember much about 111, to be honest with you. I was leaning on you for 111. 111 was good. I rated it as a fiver. I don't remember the flavor characteristics of it.
Uh-huh.
But it had. Can we put 111 back up? What was 111?
I'm pretty sure we did that one. Okay, I'm looking at that one.
It was a good smooth cigar. But I rated it a fiver.
Okay.
So let's see what 111 was. One eleven was a EP Carrillo cabinet, which makes perfect sense to me.
Okay.
Because as much as I love Ernesto Perez Carrillo, I wouldn't rate it past the fiver in my book. I think that for me, the Carrillo cabinet is good, but you should put that in a humidor for like a year or two before you smoke it.
Okay.
Like when I smoke these cigars, Will, and I smoke some of these Carrillo cabinets that I got on a tent sale, and they're good, and then the rest of my humidor, and they're a little better, and they're kind of just okay.
Yeah, that's kind of, I mean, with age, I thought they got better.
Yeah, yeah. Not. I want to like this cigar more, but I just feel like they're one that needs to be aged a long time.
Okay.
So I'm not surprised that was a Carrillo cabinet. Based on my rating. Okay, so I was 111. Now, 112 now.
No, 112 was interesting.
112 was very interesting. I thought this had a very, like, Nicaraguan kind of profile to it.
It had a very Nicaraguan profile. Yeah.
Like, it was a lot of earth with that Nicaraguan kind of twang to it for me.
There was an interesting sweetness I got up front on this cigar that went away, like, by the end of the first third.
Right.
It was a nice sweetness, and then it gave way to that Nicaraguan earth, and there was a little more spice. The second half, the combustion on this cigar was a little off for me.
Okay.
So the second half, it was burning a little warm inside. So that's kind of the negative. But I think from it had a closed footer on this thing too, and I was trying to figure out what it was.
Right.
Yeah, so I would say Nicaraguan if we're going to go with that as well.
I would agree with your assessment of Nicaraguan. I thought it had a great Nicaraguan profile.
Yeah, probably Ecuadorian Habano wrapper, if I had to say.
It did get kind of wonky in the final third for me.
Yeah, the combustion was way off on that in the second half.
So this was, and I can see it on the screen, so I know what it is already as we're talking about it. This is a Fratello White.
Bianco?
Fratello Bianco, yes.
Wow.
This was like a Corona size.
Yeah. I really like that cigar, but maybe the combustion was just off on me.
It was just off on this. And it was interesting. I had some a wrapper that was cracking on this one.
Uh-huh.
And I've been experimenting with some different cigar glues, and I didn't mix my cigar glue correctly.
So yeah, I think
it was like burning plastic because I didn't put enough water in the cigar gum. And so
yeah,
I almost couldn't give it. I mean, the first half definitely speaks Fratello Bianco, right? It had that great Nicaraguan twang, some sweetness, a little bit of earthiness, spot on. But it kind of fell apart in the second half for me too.
The combustion issue was definitely an issue for me. I would not have guessed it based on that. But yeah, normally I'm very high on that cigar. That size I like a lot.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Contests.
Yes.
Last week we didn't do a contest.
We didn't do a contest.
I had a question from last week too. Let's see if we can find that.
And we have our prize packs.
We do. This is episode 183. Is this 183 or 184?
184.
Okay.
But 183 we missed.
What do we want to do for a contest question for 183? Anyone? Contest question?
Well, last week we had on our guest from last week was why am I drawing a blank? Oh, Fabian from La Galera. Indian Head Cigars.
Oh, yeah. And I had a great, I had a great question, too. It was something to do with the countries or something.
Was it a show question or?
It was. That was 182 we had Fabian on?
183 we had Fabian on.
That was last week.
Glen Loop was 182.
Okay. 182 are all set. So we need 183?
183 was Fabian, and then 184 is...
Is this episode.
Is this episode.
Okay. So who is the blender that Fabian Barrantes works with?
Very easy one. That's
very
a solvable
easy question.
One. Yeah. Yep.
Let's put up let's put up that question, the prize pack, rather. Yes. Who is the blender? So this is like a smattering... of
sponsor sampler.
Sponsor samples. What's the one in the middle? I recognize all.
That's a Sungrown, Rocky Patel.
Yeah,
Sungrown.
Rocky Patel Sungrown.
Maduro, yep.
Yeah, this is an M Bombay. That's the A size. It's a Saga Golden Age and a PDR Sungrown?
That's the PDR Habano. Sungrown. Yeah, Sungrown Habano.
And that Partagas C Fuentes 60 ring.
That's the
Gigante. Extra Fuertes. Thank you.
Yep.
So that's a sponsor five pack, which is awesome. That M Bombay is a lot of smoking time, and then M Bombay. So tell
that's
us who not, the.
That's a very premium cigar too. That we're giving away with that one yet.
Yes, it is. All good cigars there. That's a great five pack. So answer that question from last week when we had Fabian Barrantes on the show. Who is the blender that Fabian is working with? Very famous blender.
Yep.
Okay. Now we need a question for this show.
If you don't have one, I have one.
All right. Go ahead, Will. I have one, but it was way too easy again.
All right. Name the region of Mexico where the blue agave tequila plant is grown.
Excellent. The region where the blue agave tequila...
Where the city of tequila is.
City of tequila. We're looking for that city. And put up the prize pack. This
Region. Yep. The region of Mexico.
This is from... help me out.
Crossfire Cigars.
Crossfire Cigars pack. That was taken in our new light box. That looks pretty cool. They look like the cigars are just floating there. It's awesome. And I tell you what. That Connecticut is also awesome. By the way, that's another awesome Connecticut that I smoked this year. That Crossfire Connecticut. The guys had to fight me. They're like, we need at least five cigars for this prize pack. And I'm like, you can't have this Connecticut. No. And I put it in the prize pack. So
yep, that's episode 176 we had them on. And they have some good cigars.
Absolutely.
Yep.
So email the answers to those questions at the show at stogiegeeks.com. You'll win the five pack when we pick your name at random. And you'll get a Stewie Geeks Smoke Naked T-shirt with that as well.
Yeah. Now, next week's a kind of a end of an era show because it's the last Thursday show.
The last Thursday show.
Yep.
I tell you what.
And we move to Monday.
I'm excited. For a lot of reasons in the Stewie Geeks history. This is our fifth year?
We're going to have our fifth year? Yeah.
This is our fifth year. We've been doing it mostly on Thursday nights. I mean, maybe a couple we switched, but 95% of our episodes have been on Thursday nights at 8:30-ish.
Yep.
And now with a lot of recent changes, we're able to move to Monday nights, which is better.
Yeah,
we're
going to
be at 6:30. It's going to be a little earlier, which I think is good. We've traditionally come after my podcast that I'm doing in the 11th year in security. We've done Stogie Geeks after that, which makes for a very long night for a lot of people.
It does. And I think the show's grown where it needs its own night right now.
And we're going to May 9th, man. We're going to have our own night. It's going to be a Monday night. It's going to be fabulous.
We have some big guests too the next couple weeks. So rounding out next week, it looks like we have Justo Arroyo, who is Christian Arroyo's brother, who's got his own company.
Excellent.
And then we kick off that Monday, and I'm just like a kid when Nestor Miranda's on. I get very giddy. Nestor and Jason Wood will be on to kick off the
Monday. Two characters in the industry.
Yeah, you're not gonna want to miss that.
No, certainly not. Who knows what's gonna happen in that episode?
No, we've been trying to get Nestor for a while again, and we had to reschedule a couple times, but we will have him on May 9th, where we'll be kicking off the new Stogie Geeks. And, you know, you and I have been talking, and we have some real exciting projects we're going to be rolling out.
Absolutely.
We're really heading into this 5th year anniversary with some exciting stuff, so stay tuned.
Absolutely. Well, thanks, everyone, for watching the Stogie Geek Show next Thursday night, 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Then after that, we're going to be on Monday nights at 6:30 p.m.
And we're always on demand.
Always on demand.
24/7. That's 24/7.
Go to StogieGeeks.com. You can watch all of our shows, this show, Stogie Geeks Short, Stogie Geeks News. They're all there at StogieGeeks.com. Thanks, everyone, for watching. We'll see everyone on the next episode.